Hello friends, I hope you all are going wonderful. I, C.A. Pujinkapadia, welcome you all on my today's lecture on the subject Mercantile Law. Friends, as you all are very well aware, we had started with the Act, the Indian Contract Act 1872, under which we have covered several topics, starting from the basic definitions. Then after, we have taken up a topic of what is a valid contract, what all are the essential elements of the valid contract. Moving ahead of which, I have taken a deep topic of classification of contracts, which we have broadly covered into last two lectures. Under this particular topic, I had explained the classification of contracts on three broad bases, which include, first, on the basis of validity, second was on the basis of formation, and third was on the basis of performance. I hope that you all are very well aware with all the topics that we have covered till date. So now, friends, today we are going to start with a very new and fresh topic. The name of the topic that we are going to start with is offer and acceptance. I hope you all are very well aware with those two words, what is offer and what is acceptance, because we have dealt the same topic in the definition. So today what I am going to do is, I am going to take the first topic, that is offer, under which we are going to study three important points. First is the meaning, the definition of offer. Second, legal rules with regards to offer. And third is, how can a offer can be cancelled or revoked. So let's start today's topic with the definition of offer of proposal. This is the same slide that I have taught you in our basic chapter, but this is the name of the chapter and definition may be asked from this unit too. Again, it is stated in the same act, as a result of which it is going to remain same. It is nothing, it is just a mere repetition, but since we are going to study the topic of offer, I feel it is necessary that you should start with a definition. So let's take a quick overview on what we have studied already, that is definition of offer or proposal. It has been defined under section 2, clause A. Let's read what it wants to say is, when one person signifies to another. So basically there are minimum two persons which are required. One party is signifying to another. What is signifying? His willingness to do or to abstain from doing anything. As I have told you what I am doing, I am showing my willingness. Kuch karne ke liye ya kuch na karne ke liye. Remember the example of venture capitalist? Yes. And the person to the Ola businessmen that I am telling that please don't do business in this particular area. So it is nothing. It is to do or abstain from doing anything. What is my objective? With a view to obtaining the assent of that another to such act or abstinence. What I want basically is, the person to whom I am actually showing my willingness, that is in our example, if I'm asking venture capitalist to come and invest in my company, I want that he should give assent, he should give confirmation that yes, I'm ready to invest in your company. So basically, this is said to be the proposal or the offer. In short, what I can make out of this definition is, firstly, it is defined under section 2, clause A. Minimum requirement is of two parties. One person is signifying, showing his willingness to another person. For what? For two things. Either to do something or to abstain from doing something. That is, kuch karne ke liye ya kuch na karne ke liye. What is his main motive? His main motive is to get the assent, get the confirmation from the other person to whom he is making an offer. If this is the case, it is said to be offer or proposal. You can learn the keywords that I have mentioned over here. First is willingness, second is assent, third is to do, and fourth is abstain. We have already covered this in much detail, so I am just quickly giving you 30 seconds. Take a quick overview on what I have stated over here. Well, friends, I hope with this, you are all set to start with the topic. The topic that we are basically going to look in detail in our today's lecture is legal rules as to offer. You will say, sir, offer kya hai, wo toh samajh mein aa gaya. But as per law, which all are the legal rules that we are supposed to follow in order to make your offer valid? So we need to understand one by one, each and every rules which are legal, which are applicable to make an offer valid. So let's take it one by one. The first rule that I have written over here is your offer should be capable of creating legal relationship. Let's look at what is written over here. Intention should be to create legal relationship. We have seen the same point by studying the essential elements of the valid contract. My intention should be to create legal relationship. The same point is being written over here. So what is important over here is whenever I am showing my willingness, whenever I am making an offer, my intention out of that offer should be to create legal relationship. Social or domestic offers, even if accepted, won't result into a legal relations or a valid contract. As you all are very well aware, remember the example in which I have told that I have made a proposal that I am going to take my family members on a road trip once in a month. Fine. Again, I was showing my willingness. So it was an offer, but it was not a legal offer. This offer was just a domestic or a social offer. As a result of which, even if my family members are accepting my offer, it is not going to create any kind of legal relations or valid contract. As a result of which, whensoever you are making any kind of offer, it should be made with an intention to create legal relationship. Let's take an example. I'm inviting my friend for a dinner. Whenever I'm inviting my friend for a dinner, it is merely a social invitation, which even accepted won't result into legal relations. Fine. I hope you are clear with this particular point. What they want to say is your intention should be to create legal relationship. If I am entering into a contract or what I am doing is I am just making a proposal. I am just asking my friend. I am inviting him. Just come to my place and we will have a dinner together. I have invited. I have given an offer. But this offer is just a domestic offer. It has no intention to create legal relationship. In case, afterwards, if I cancel this plan, then also he is not having any kind of right that he can sue me. He can file a case against me. Fine. So there is no legal intention. The only intention is domestic intention. In short, in the first rule, what they want to say is your intention should be to create legal relationship. It should not be merely a social or a domestic purpose. I hope I'm clear with this point, right? So let's move ahead to the second rule. The terms of offer, that is whatsoever terms and conditions are stated in the offer, it should be definite and certain. I hope you are clear with the meaning of this word, just a normal meaning, definite. That is up to the mark and certain. That is, it should be clear. It should not be ambiguous. It should not be vague. Fine. First point I have written over here is the term should not be unambiguous or vague. Here it should be the word ambiguous. What I want to say over here is it's only one thing. Whatsoever terms I'm keeping in my offer, it should not be vague. It should not be unclear. Each and everything, each and every terms which I'm mentioning in the offer should be clear, should be easily interpreted. Fine. It should not be like that I am telling something, but it can have another meaning also. It should be taken in the same sense in which I want to say. As a result of which, I need to focus. I should show my willingness in an offer in such a manner that it is easily understood in the same manner to the person to whom I am making the offer. As a result of which, the terms of the offer, the conditions, the words that I am using at the time of making the offer, I should ensure myself that I am using the definites and the certain terms in that particular thing. Second point what I have written over here is, if the terms are not clear, let's assume that I have written something which is not at all clear. Fine. Then what will happen? No contract can be entered into because it is not clear what exactly the parties are intended to do. अगर बता ही नहीं होगा कि क्या करना है, then it is not possible can I can fulfill my promise, right? If I'm asking venture capitalist to come and invest in my company, then he'll get to know, okay, yes, I'm offering him to invest. If I'm not saying anything, I'm just telling him, come. Then he is not going to understand for what I'm calling him. As a result of which, what I want to say over here is, whatsoever terms you are using in the offer, it should be definite and it should be certain. It should not be having double meaning. It should not be unclear. The party to whom the offer is made should be in a position to understand the terms clearly. Fine. So that is a basic rule that is stated over here. Now to make our understanding more clear, I have taken a good example so that you can clear out this particular topic. In this example, I have written, if Mr. X offers to sell 100 liters of oil to Mr. Y. So what is the situation? Mr. X is making an offer that he wants to sell 100 liters of oil to Mr. Y. Now I have taken two scenarios. In case one, Mr. X is a dealer of coconut and mustard oil. So basically Mr. X is a dealer of oil he is dealing into two different types of oil, that is coconut oil and mustard oil. Then I can say this offer that I've stated over here is not certain. Why it is not certain? Because I have not clarified that whether I want to sell coconut oil or whether I want to sell mustard oil. As a result of which, we can say the terms of offer are not certain. I hope you are getting the point. Why? Because Mr. X is dealing into two different types of oils. So he is not basically stating of which oil he is actually offering for sale. As a result of which, in case when this offer, the terms of the offer are not certain. Let's take second case. Mr. X is a dealer again, but of only coconut oil. He is selling only one product. What is that product? Coconut oil. Now in this particular case, it is implied that the offer that is made over here is of coconut oil only, because Mr. X is not selling anything else. As a result of which, I can say the terms of offer are certain. So you can see, friends, here the statement of offer is the same, but depending on the situation, the terms may be certain, may not be certain. I hope you are clear with this particular point. I would just like to request you to take a quick overview on the content that I have written on this particular slide. So, are you clear, friends, with my terms of explanation? I hope yes. Fine. So, let's move to the third point. The third point is, offer must be communicated. What they want to say over here is, whensoever I am showing my willingness, fine, whensoever I am making an offer, it is important that I should communicate my offer to the person to whom I am making. Fine. You are getting the heading. Let's read inside what is written. First point is, awareness of the offer is necessary in order to accept and create legal relations, so it is to be communicated. For example, in our example, I was offering venture capitalist to come and invest in my company. Fine. So basically, I was making an offer. Whom I am making the offer? To the venture capitalist. Now in this particular example, if I am not communicating venture capitalist that I am giving him an offer, he is not going to come to know that actually I have made an offer. As a result of which, he would be totally unaware about my offer and he cannot accept the offer because he is not knowing only that I have made an offer. So the important point over here, friends, is whensoever you are making an offer, it should be properly communicated to the person to whom it is made. Clear? Okay. Now we are going to take two different scenarios in example. That is second point and third point. We need to understand it technically. So let's read it out. The first point, that is second point written over here is, Mr. A sent his servant S to find his lost boy B. So the story over here is Mr. A, who has sent his servant S to find his lost boy B. Mr. A ka bachcha ghum gaya jiska naam kya tha? B. So usko dhoondne ke liye unhone kisko bheja? Unke servant ko jiska naam tha S. I hope I am clear with the situation. Later, when the servant has already went out to find the boy, what happened? He has declared a reward of rupees 1 lakh for finding B. Matlab, servant has already left for finding the boy. Later, that is after that, Mr. Hay has declared the reward of rupees 1 lakh for finding his boy B. Now, S was unaware about it. S ko nahi pata tha ki Mr. A ne ye reward declare kiya hai. S, in the general terms, found B and brought him to the home. So, I hope you are clear till now, like what is the situation. Mr. A has declared the reward. Jo bhi mere bachche ko dhoond ke layega, we are going to pay him 1 lakh rupees. But S, that was the servant whom he has sent, was not at all aware about this declaration of the reward. S, in his general course, found the boy and brought him home. Then, S came to know about the reward and claimed it. S ko bata chala baad mein. So, what does S did? He claimed the reward for the particular part. it was held in the case that S was not entitled to the reward, being he was another. So important point over here is, Mr. A had actually made an offer to public that whosoever is finding my boy, Mr. B, he is entitled to claim a reward of rupees 1. But when this offer was made, S, that is the servant, was not at all aware about the same. And he has found the boy, not because of the reward. He has found the boy in general course. In short, the offer was not being properly communicated to S. Or we can say Mr. S was unaware about the offer which was made by Mr. A. As a result of which, Mr. S cannot claim that reward amount. I hope this situation and case is clear with you. See friends, just remember, many of the examples that I am giving over here are the case laws. But I am just using simple names, as a result of which it becomes easier for you guys to understand the case. So I am not technically using all the words, but I am using the same context that was actually the part of the case law. So friends, with this, I hope you are clear. Awareness of the offer is mandatory. So the offer needs to be communicated in a proper manner. Next point is, that is third point, motive doesn't matter when you are aware about the offer. Now let's change this scenario. Like again, Mr. A, who has the servant S and his lost boy B. Mr. A is declaring the reward of rupees 1 lakh. But now S was aware of this offer, and so what he did is he went to find the boy. Can you understand that change that I am making in this example? Fine. So what is the scenario now? Mr. A had made the offer, so the servant is going to find the boy. Now, servant is basically not finding the boy because he is going to get the reward. His motive was simple, that since he is doing job for long for Mr. A, it is his moral responsibility that he should find the servant. So what was the motive of the servant over here? The motive was just to be faithful to the owner. As a result of which, he went on and found the boy B. Now, S has claimed the reward. Now, in this particular case, Mr. A said that the motive of S was not to get the reward. His motive was just being faithful to me. But what the court held in this particular case was, motive is not at all of importance when a person is aware about the offer. So, Mr. S, that was the servant, though his motive was not under reward, it was just to be faithful to Mr. A, he has full rights to claim the reward of rupees 1 lakh. Why? Because he was well aware of the offer, and after being aware of the offer, he has started his search. I hope I am making sense with this particular example. So what I want to tell you guys is, first point that we need to remember, offer must be communicated. Second, the person to whom the offer is made should be aware about the offer. And the third point is, your motive doesn't matter at all, whether you are doing it for good or you are doing it for bad. Since you are doing after being aware or after being communicated of the offer, you are entitled to accept that particular offer. So we have discussed three important points in this particular slide via two examples. First was, offer needs to be communicated. Second is, important point, one should be aware about the offer before its acceptance. And third is, your motive is not important at the time of accepting the offer. Fine friends, just take a quick read over the example and the point that I have stated over here. Well, friends, let's move ahead to the next point. Point number 4. Offer may be conditional. What they want to say over here is, whensoever you are making an offer, your offer may have certain conditions that are supposed to be fulfilled before accepting the same. As a result of which, what I can say is, it is not necessary that offer needs to be absolute. It can be conditional also. Now, let's read what is written over here. First point is stating, proposer is free to keep any terms and conditions, no matter how hard or ridiculous it may be. So whenever you are offering someone, whenever you are proposing someone, it is not necessary that how hard or how ridiculous your conditions are. You are totally free that you can keep any kind of conditions you wish. Because then after, it is totally up to acceptor whether he want to accept the offer or reject the offer. It is his choice. So as a proposer or as an offerer, you are not bound by anything. You can keep any terms and conditions you wish to keep in your particular offer. Second point is, terms and conditions, that is TNCs, should be properly communicated to the offeree so that he is aware about the same before acceptance. This is the most important point. Whenever I am making a conditional offer, that is, whenever I am adding certain terms and conditions at the time of making an offer, I should properly communicate the acceptor, that is the person who is going to accept the offer, all the terms and conditions in a clear manner so that before acceptance, he is aware, no, this offer is along with the terms and conditions. So what does the second point says? Before acceptance, the person to whom the offer is made should be well communicated all the conditions which are stated in the offer. Fine? Okay. Now let's take two examples. In the third point I have written, whenever we are purchasing any kind of gadgets, it is always coming electronic gadgets, basically I'm talking about, it is coming with the warranty card or the warranty is fine. There is always a small leaflet of all the terms and conditions of warranty. So let's take an example. I am going out to purchase a television. Fine. Now at the time of purchasing television, the shopkeeper tells me that you are having 1 year free warranty subject to the terms and conditions which are stated in this booklet. Now what I am doing is, I feel, what is the purpose of reading this booklet? So without reading the booklet, I am entering into a contract and I am purchasing this particular television. It is implied that I am bound by all the conditions which are stated in that particular leaflet, even though I have not read the same. Why? Because the seller, that is the person who has offered me to sell that particular television, has clearly communicated me before my acceptance that, sir, it is subject to all the terms and conditions which are mentioned in the leaflet. In short, what I want to say over here is, I cannot make an excuse that I have accepted the contract without reading the conditions of the offer. No, that cannot be the excuse. So what I want to remember over here is, whensoever the acceptor is being properly communicated about the conditions to the offer, he is bound by all the conditions which are stated in that particular offer. Are you clear? Okay. Okay, fine. Let's move to the last point. A client is not bound for loss of his personal belongings in hotel where terms and conditions are mentioned inside the room and not outside on reception. Let me elaborate this example. Suppose I am going on a holiday. Fine. I am going to check in into an hotel. Now, before booking my room, what I'll do? I'll go to the reception and ask whether there is room availability. Reception wala guy will say, yes, sir. Room number, for example, 101 is available. What I'll do is, I'll pay him. He'll give me the keys and I'll enter into the room. Now, whensoever I'm entering into a room, inside a room, there is a board or a display board on which it is written that owner is not responsible for any kind of loss of my property, that is of the property of the guest. Fine. So what is the context over here is, I am entering into a contract when at the reception. I hope you are getting my example. When I entered into a contract at the reception, does the hotel management inform me about the conditions at the reception? Answer is here, no. They have not informed me or they have not kept any display board at the reception. Fine. So I have entered into a contract. Till the time I entered into a contract, there was no communication of this condition that they are not responsible for my belongings. When I came to know, after I have already entered into a contract, that is after I have taken the room, I am entering into the room and then I am getting that condition. Now in this particular case, I am not bound to that particular condition. So if my belongings are being lost, I can claim to the hotel management for such loss. Are you getting the difference? So in this particular example, what happened? Conditions were there, but conditions were communicated to me after I entered into the contract. So basically, I am not at all bound by those particular conditions. So basically, there is a small difference between the example 3, where I was communicated before entering into a contract, and in the fourth point, after the contract was entered. I hope I'm clear. So important point over here is, whensoever we are making the offer, which is conditional. In that particular case, we should well communicate the person to whom the offer is made before his acceptance, that is before the contract is entered into. Just take a quick overview on all the points which are stated over here, and please take due care of the examples. Well, friends, I hope you have taken a good overview of the points which are stated over here. So let's recall what we have covered till now. The first point was what is offer or what is proposal when one person is signifying to another his willingness kuch karne ke liye, kuch na karne ke liye, that is to do or to abstain from doing. What is my main objective is to get the assent from that another person. And this is named as proposal or offer. We find under section 2 clause A. Then we started with the legal rules as to offer. What all are the rules that are supposed to be kept in mind while the time of making the offer? Under which we have seen the first point, that my intention should be of creating the legal relationship. Social or domestic offers are not basically the offer which are capable of making a valid contract. As a result of which, whensoever I am making an offer, I should have in mind the intention to create the legal relationship. Second is, whatsoever terms or offer I am keeping about, they should be definite and certain. They should not be vague. They should not be such which are having double meaning. It should be very well clear. Under which I have given you the example of the person who is offering to sell oil. Fine. If he is a person who is dealing into different kind of oils, then this offer terms are not said to be certain. But if he is dealing only in one kind of oil, then this offer terms are said to be certain. In short, situation is the one. It totally depends on case to case basis. So what we want to focus over here is the terms of the offer, that is the words that I am using, the terms I am keeping at the time of making the offer should be definite and certain. Third point we have studied, offer must be properly communicated. Fine. Awareness of offer is important. Without awareness, I cannot accept the offer. Under which we have taken the example of the lost boy and the reward amount. Fine. Motive is not at all important, that we have discussed in the third point. Your motive may be right, it may be wrong. Motive is not at all of the concern. What is of the concern? Awareness of the offer. And in order to bring awareness, we need to properly communicate the offer. Fourth point is, offer may be conditional. There can be terms and conditions in the offer. What is the golden rule over here? Those terms and conditions should be very well communicated in advance before acceptance to the person to whom the offer is made. Let the example of purchasing the electronic gadgets, fine, the leaflet of terms and conditions. But at the same time, in the hotel wala example, when I was informed about the terms and conditions, it was too late because I have already accepted the offer. So those conditions are not binding on me. Friends, we are just at the halfway of this particular answer. We are going to continue with this particular answer in the next lecture. So I hope to see you soon in my next lecture. Thank you, friends.